Morning to everybody. Let's continue with our series on spiritual difference making in the workplace. And for our introduction, we go back to our definition of what spiritual difference making is all about. A spiritual difference making happens when a believer makes a difference in the spiritual lives of others through his values, through his attitudes, through his actions. And the last message we had about spiritual difference making, we forwarded this proposition that the workplace is a conducive place for spiritual difference making. What does it mean when we say that the workplace is a conducive place? It simply means that the workplace is an environment favorable to, beneficial to, good for, helpful, instrumental in, and useful for spiritual difference making. And we gave 5 reasons why the workplace is a conducive, a helpful place for spiritual difference making. There is facility or ease of entry. Introductions has already been made. The worker belongs to the workplace. He is already there. A second reason is he shares common interests. He has established relationships with his co-workers and work associates. The third reason is he has already credibility. They know him. Unlike missionaries for the first time, he's acclimatized. There's therefore a shorter gestation period to be familiar with the place and its co-workers. The fourth reason is he's there, very visible. He has time to mingle with the co-workers, and he's available when the need arises. The fifth reason is this. It has been found out that spiritual values are beneficial even in terms of secular yardsticks. It's beneficial to co-workers and the company itself in terms of customer relations, in terms of profits, in terms of relationships among employees. This morning we'll discuss another aspect of spiritual difference making. While we say that it's conducive, spiritual difference making is also a challenging place. What are the challenges to spiritual difference making in the workplace? Basically, it boils down to this, that there is resistance on the part of non-believers. And this resistance comes from perceptions and believers performing spiritual difference-making efforts in the workplace. What are the issues of these co-workers who are unbelievers? In a study conducted, they placed 3 reasons why spiritual difference-making turns them off in the workplace. The first is the perception. Maybe not true, but it's a perception that believers are hypocritical. They're hypocrites. The second perception is believers are out of touch with reality. And last but not least, believers are too judgmental. They are uncaring in their relationship with non-believers. Let's look at the first issue, the point of being hypocritical. Unbelievers consider believers as hypocritical. They say one thing and they do another. That's their observation. Unbelievers say Christians pretend to be something unreal, conveying a polished message, image that's not accurate. That's hypocrisy. The second issue is believers are out of touch with reality. Outsiders say they are sheltered, too sheltered. They do not respond to reality in appropriately complex ways, preferring simplistic solutions and answers. Believers are perceived as not willing to deal with the grit and grime of people's lives. The third issue is the fact that believers are perceived as judgmental. They are too focused on getting converts. Outsiders wonder if believers genuinely care about them. Outsiders feel that believers first treat them like targets rather than people, enforced through their persuasions. They're too focused. They're not honest about their attitudes and perspectives about other people. Unbelievers doubt that believers really love them as they say they do. They're also think of believers as quick to judge others. Now, how do we respond to this co-worker unbeliever issues? We normally observe this. Too often, Christians in the workplace take an us versus them attitude in our relationship with unbelievers. Believers just group together and isolate themselves from unbelievers. This clearly was not the attitude of the Apostle Paul, and this is contrary to his admonition in such an atmosphere. In 1 Thessalonians 2, verses 7-8, he says, "But we were gentle among you, even as a nurse cherisheth her children. So being affectionately desirous of you, we were willing to have imparted unto you not the gospel of God only, but also our own souls, because you were dear to us." 1 Thessalonians 2, 7, 8. Colossians 4, 5, 6. "Walk in wisdom toward them that are without," those non-believers, redeeming the time. Verse 6, "Let your speech, let your conduct, let your behavior always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer every man." Colossians 4, verses 5 to 6. I got another translation from the Living Bible. And the advice is, instead of isolating ourselves from unbelievers, Colossians 4, 5, 6 states it in the Living Bible translation, "Make the most of your chances to tell others the good news. Be wise in all your contacts with them. Let your conversation be gracious as well as sensible, for then you will have the right answer for everyone." Living Bible translation. How do we heed Paul's advice, therefore, insofar as our relationship with unbelievers in the workplace are concerned, insofar as addressing the three issues of hypocrisy, of being too focused, and being uncaring? How do we face this challenge? The issues raised by unbelievers cannot be addressed by what we call talk and talk about the gospel. We cannot also face the challenge by walk and walk. Definitely not the talk and talk approach, because we cannot convince unbelievers by our mere words, by our arguments, however forceful they are. In a sense, they've already prejudged our position. Not also the walk and walk approach, because, to quote John Piper, "Thinking that our work in the workplace will glorify God when people do not even know we are Christians is like admiring an effective ad on TV that never mentions the product. People may be impressed, but won't know what to buy because we do not even mention that we are Christians. The walk and walk can be ineffective. We look at the walk and then talk approach because we believe that actions speak louder than words. And we do this by developing personal relationships with unbelievers. Through our relationship with them, we let ourselves better known to them. They'll be able to know better, to know us better. As they say in evangelism, no impact if there's no contact. We now go to the walk then talk approach. What does it mean? If we are not considering the talk and talk, we're not considering the walk and walk, what does it mean to use this approach in the workplace of walking then talking? In walking then talking, the believer lives an attractive and holy life among his co-workers. A life that captures the attention of his co-workers such that this would lead eventually to an opportunity to share the gospel. The walk then talk approach means that the believer lives and works in such a way that unbelievers in the workplace become curious about his conduct and behavior, and he needs to be able and willing to share the reason behind, which is his faith. Our reference for the walk then talk approach, Ephesians 4 verses 1 and 2. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love. Another biblical reference for the walk then talk, 2 Corinthians 8:21, providing for honest things, not only in the sight of the Lord, but also in the sight of men. 1 Peter 2:12, another reference, having your conversation, having your conduct, having your behavior honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. Let me tell you a story, a very illustrative one, for the walk then talk approach. Francis of Assisi once visited a young monk to join him on a trip to town to preach. Honored to be given the invitation, the monk readily accepted. All day long, he and Francis walked through the streets, byways, and alleys, and even to the suburbs. They rubbed shoulders with hundreds of people. At day's end, the two headed back home. Not even once had Francis addressed a crowd, nor had he talked to anyone about the gospel. Greatly disappointed, his young companion said, I thought we were going into town to preach. Francis responded, my son, we have preached. We were preaching while we were walking. We were seen by many, and our behavior was closely watched. It is of no use to walk anywhere to preach unless we preach everywhere as we walk. Let me summarize the walk then talk approach through a poem. It starts this way. The Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are read by more than a few. But the one that is most read and commented is the Gospel according to you. You're writing a Gospel, a chapter each day, by the things you do and the words that you say. Men read what you write, whether faithless or true, say, what is the gospel according to you? Do men read his truth and his love in your life? Or has yours been too full of malice and strife? Does your life speak of evil and does it ring true? Say, what is the gospel according to you? Let's now look into the nature of spiritual difference making in the workplace. We have noted that the approach we could adopt is one of walking than talking. The premise for this spiritual difference making effort in the workplace is this. Because of the challenges spiritual difference making poses in the workplace, it has to be approached not as an event, but as a process. An event happens only once, one time, and that's it. Spiritual difference in the workplace happens as a process. It takes time. It goes through different stages. Our biblical reference is 1 Corinthians 3, 5-7. Verse 5, "Who then is Paul and who is Apollos? But ministers by whom you believe, and even as the Lord gave to every man. I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth, but God that giveth the increase." It's a stage of watering, of planting, of preparing the ground. That's spiritual difference making. So we have the so-called 3P process of spiritual difference making in the workplace. We have first P, the presence, we have proclamation, and we have persuasion. Stage one of presence means that we make our presence felt in the workplace. We make our presence noticed as Christians. The second stage, through our behavior, through our conduct, through our walk, we ignite interest as a result and give the opportunity to share the gospel. The third, when the ground is ready, we persuade them toward conversion. This morning we'll talk about the first stage, presence. How do we establish our presence? How do we make unbelievers notice that we are different? How would we create interest in us so that they will come to us and ask, what is wrong or what's right with you? It basically means establishing presence. It basically means, in this nutshell, the gospel can be seen from us before it's even heard. It means a quiet testimony of our conduct and behavior. This is in contrast to confrontational and forcing through conversations or witnessing. We behave as Christians quietly. What is the context of this? That by establishing personal relationship with our co-workers, because if there's no contact, there would be no impact in their lives. So what are the prerequisites in order for us to establish our Christian presence in the workplace? What are the things we can do in order to create interest and open the ground for the gospel? Three prerequisites for presence. First, we must have personal integrity even in the most difficult situations. The second element, we should work excellently, deliver excellent results, be outstanding workers. And the third, we must have caring relationships, not only with fellow believers, but unbelievers in the workplace. If we look at these three elements, they address the unbelievers' concerns insofar as our spiritual difference-making efforts are concerned. When we talk of personal integrity, even in the most difficult situations, and be able to live with this integrity, then we are given the opportunity to erase that perception of hypocrisy in our lives. When we work in excellence, when we are diligent and deliver outstanding performance, they cannot accuse us of being out of touch from reality. When we are caring and loving, then we erase that perception of being judgmental and non-caring. Establishing our presence, what does it mean? This is the key to unlocking the door for spiritual difference making. Because we make our presence felt, we get noticed. Walk the walk is the approach in order to get the opportunity to talk the talk. I got this commentary, and I think it's appropriate. Jesus himself did not try to convert the two thieves on the cross. He waited until one of them turned to him. Walking, then talking. Let's talk about the first element. Personal integrity in the workplace. The believer must possess personal integrity in the workplace because he's under the relentless scrutiny of non-believers 24/7. Integrity within this context refers to consistency between a person's inner values and attitudes and his outward words and actions. Integrity is consistency, integer, oneness in both what's inside and what is outward. From a biblical viewpoint, integrity means being morally sound. In other words, a person with integrity knows what is important to God and consistently lives in light of what is important to God. Morally sound. From a biblical viewpoint, integrity involves more than living our own values. It involves subscribing to God's values and, with his help, learning to conform our conduct to those godly values. Let's look at the example of Samuel in 1 Samuel 11:2-4 as a worker who has demonstrated personal integrity. And Samuel said unto all Israel, "Behold, I've hearkened unto your voice in all that you said unto me, and have made a king over you." Verse 2, "And now behold, the king walketh before you, and I'm old and gray-headed, and behold, my sons are with you. And I have walked before you from my childhood unto this day." Verse 3, "Behold, here I am, witness against me before the Lord and before his anointed, whose ox have I taken, or whose ass have I taken, or whom have I defrauded, whom have I oppressed, or of whose hand have I received any bribe to blind mine eyes therewith, and I will restore it you." In verse 4, "And they said, thou hast not defrauded us, nor oppressed us, neither hast thou taken oath of any man's hand." That's personal integrity for you. We cannot pinpoint anything wrong with what you have done. Samuel's personal integrity permeated every aspect of his life. His integrity directed how he regarded his possessions, his business dealings, and his treatment of those who were weaker than himself. Samuel opened himself up to the scrutiny of everyone with whom he had ever had dealings. And there was nothing wrong as far as they're concerned. Personal integrity. How would a believer demonstrate it in the workplace? With integrity, a believer's life is characterized by honesty, by truthfulness, and transparency. In the workplace, a believer should have nothing to hide. The next point that we drive at this personal integrity is we test ourselves. I got 10 questions for each and every one of us. How can we measure our integrity in the workplace or even in our daily lives? Let's consider the following questions. What are you like when no one else is around? Are you consistent with when people are around, or are you consistent when nobody's looking? How do you treat others who cannot benefit from you? Or you treat others differently, those from whom you benefit, those from whom don't benefit? How sincere, humble, and transparent are you? Are you the same person when you are with different people? Are you the same person in public as in private? Do you quickly admit to yourself and others when you are wrong? Do you subscribe to God's absolute moral standard in His word, or you embrace relativism? Do you talk to people or about them behind their backs? Are you accountable to at least one person for what you think, say, and do? And do you submit to God's Spirit and seek to please Him in all you do? So those are the questions we ask ourselves to test our personal integrity, to prepare ourselves in the walk, then talk in the workplace. The second element has to do with how we work. And in order to be noticed, in order to get the attention of people in the workplace, we should work with excellence. Co-workers inevitably associate our conduct at work with our faith. When we are working for the Lord, our ability to handle our jobs and deal with others make us stand out among our co-workers, or vice versa. Look at this commentary. One may mention Christ in every other sentence. I've experienced this. Diyos, minsan may mga tao na lahat ng sasabihin mo, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Lumalakas pa yung praise the Lord. Di ba? So the one may mention Christ in every other sentence, but it would not matter if you are a time waster, if you are a complainer, a gossiper, or an ineffective, disrespectful, and careless employee. You have lost the right to be a living testimony for Christ. Excellence in the workplace challenge. Excellence, biblically speaking, is the result of pursuing and doing the best we can with the gifts and abilities God gives us, and giving our best with the motivation for the glory of God. That's excellence in the workplace for a believer. Pursuing and doing the best with all the gifts God has given us and the abilities, and we're doing it to the glory of God. Excellence done without the spirit of competition, as the world understands it, or seeking to excel simply to be better than others. Excellent includes doing common everyday things in very uncommon ways, regardless of whether people are watching. Excellence comes from doing our best with what we have to God's glory, with a view to growing and improving in our lives, but not with a view to the score or who is watching from man's standpoint. Excellence, as far as the Christian is concerned in the workplace, is not to be limited by the nature of his tasks. We are to do whatever we do, whether it's viewed as important by society or very menial or insignificant. Excellence means that all is to be done to the glory of God. Regardless of what we do, it deserves our best in the long run. It reflects on the honor and glory of our God and will ultimately be rewarded by Him. Excellence is never a matter of simply choosing between what is good or bad. Excellence is choosing what is best or superior because it will better enable us to accomplish what God has designed us to be and to do. Pursuing excellence in the workplace is an all-inclusive pursuit, doing our very best in everything we do. Ecclesiastes 9:10, whatever your hands finds to do, verily do it with all your might, for there's no activity or planning or knowledge or wisdom in Sheol where you're going. 1 Corinthians 10:31, and excellence, whether then you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Excellence for the Christian is a matter of a wholehearted endeavor, involving the inner person and proceeds from an inner faith relationship with God. It calls for a wholehearted endeavor in whatever we do as Christians. Matthew 23:37-38, and Jesus said to him, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. What is our biblical reference for excellence? In his letter to the Philippians, chapter 1, verse 9, Paul wrote, and this I pray, that your love may abound or may excel yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment. 1 Corinthians 15:58, and the admonition to excel in everything we do, including the workplace. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work, always excelling, always doing very well. That's the meaning of abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. 1 Corinthians 15:58. 1 Corinthians 10:31. Another popular reference for excellence. Whatever therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. Colossians 3:23-24, whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and unto men, knowing that of the Lord you shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ. Colossians 3:23-27. We do excellent work in the workplace by doing ordinary things in extraordinarily manner. And we do this first through diligence and second by avoiding laziness. Diligence, what does it mean? What does it mean to be diligent in the workplace? It is persevering and careful in our work. It's being industrious. It's being doing our work with care, with steady effort. We do it painstakingly. That's diligence. An example of a diligent man is the artist who paints each strand of hair on a portrait. That's the picture's description of a diligent person. Painting each strand of hair on a portrait. Since our work is a stewardship from God, then diligence is essential. God's word tells us that if we don't work, we should not eat. Another aspect of hindrance to excellence is laziness. And the Bible is wrote with verses discouraging us to be lazy. And in the workplace, laziness is a strong factor that would be, or a strong obstacle towards creating our presence. First, because laziness is irritating to others. While others are working, you're doing your texting. Proverbs 10:26, as vinegar to the teeth, you see how obnoxious it is. As vinegar to the teeth and as smoke to the eyes, so is the sluggard to them that sent him. How can you create a noticeable presence when everybody is irritated? How can you make a presence and get notice when you're lazy and therefore you yourself are frustrated. Proverbs 13:4, the soul of the sluggard desireth and hath nothing, but the soul of the diligent shall be made fat. Laziness is a form of death. So how can you have consistency? Proverbs 18:9, he also that is slothful in his work is brother to him that is a great waster. Excellence. Let's put it in a nutshell. Excellence is going the extra mile. It's to make an extra effort in our jobs, in our assignments. It's to try very hard to achieve something. It's to do more than expected and to make special efforts. Go the extra mile. This is an idiomatic expression that was adopted from a commandment of our Lord Jesus Christ himself in the Sermon of the Mount. Whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, he said, go with him two or twain. Go the extra mile means that we try harder to please someone or to get the task done correctly, to do more than one is required to do to reach a goal. Under the Roman impressment law, a Roman soldier passing by a Jew could order him to carry his pack for 1 mile. Tradition has it that Christian converts who were asked by these Roman soldiers to carry the pack for them for 1 mile went the extra mile, and it resulted to many conversions of Roman soldiers. The third element, in order to get notice in the workplace, to prepare the ground for spiritual difference making, is caring relationships. The third component is how the Christians relate to people in the workplace. Believers must be pleasant to all around them and give them comfort. For Paul's converts, hospitality and generosity were part of life and witness. We look at Galatians 6:9-10, and let us not be weary in well-doing, says Paul, for in due season we shall reap, if we faint not. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. Galatians 6:9-10. 1 Thessalonians 2:7-8, and the admonition to be caring, to love even unbelievers. So being affectionately desirous of you, we're willing to have imparted unto you not the gospel of God only, but also our own souls, because you were dear unto us. This should be the foundation of our relationship with our co-workers. Peter proclaimed the gospel verbally in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost, and 3,000 were baptized into Christ. He and others showed compassion by meeting the needs of widows. Peter both shared the gospel as well as live it out. In the workplace, we should show our caring attitudes, not only in actions, but also in words. What people say has great impact on those who hear it, whether it be positive or negative. Christians are called to a high standard with their words, because this will often separate us, not only from fellow believers, but unbelievers. We should therefore use our words to establish bridges rather than serving as separating factors in our relationships. Ephesians 4:2-9 gives us the advice on how we use our words. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. Colossians 4:6, let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer every man. Proverbs 18:21, and being careful with words, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. So do we have personal integrity? Do you have a caring attitude? Do we work excellently? Let's learn how this Samaritan woman influenced people. Making a difference through living testimony. This is the lesson that the Samaritan woman teaches us. For there is certainly a power in the testimony of a life transformed by Christ, which we are expected to show in the workplace. John 4:39-41. And many of the Samaritans of that city believed in him, for the saying of the woman which testified, "He told me all that I ever did." Verse 40. So when the Samaritans were come unto him, they besought him that he might tarry with them, and he abode there 2 days. And many more believed because of his own word. Everyone in that town knew this woman and the sordid, dirty life she lived. What caused them to believe in Christ was not only her words about Jesus, but her transformed life. She was a living testimony to the power of the gospel of Christ. So impactful was the change in her life that they knew something miraculous had happened with her. So they asked Jesus to remain with them, which he did for 2 days, preaching the same gospel of repentance and the offer of the living water of eternal life through him. In this instance, both the preaching of the word of God and the testimony of a life changed by that word bore the fruit of repentance. But was the woman's life changed sufficient to bring others to the Savior? No, it was not sufficient. But it was the impetus for them to seek more information. And this is what we are driving at today, that we can get the presence, our presence noticed, in order to create the impetus for unbelievers to seek more information about the life we live. Can we today then expect that our lives will be sufficient testimony to convince unbelievers of their need for Christ, especially in the workplace? Too often the lives of Christians are not a good witness of the Lord and Savior we profess to know and serve. Too often the world sees in us more of a reflection of them than a reflection of Christ. The challenge, there are two types of witnesses, they say: the expert witness and the material witness. The expert witness testifies based mainly on his expertise, based mainly on his credentials. The material witness gives accounts on what he's based on his actual experiences, based on what he has seen and heard, and what has affected his life. Our Lord Jesus Christ today challenges us to be material witnesses. He does not want us to be mere expert witnesses. This is a daunting challenge, but let this closing anecdote give us the inspiration. While walking along a beach, an elderly gentleman saw someone in the distance leaning down, picking something up and throwing it into the ocean. As he got closer, he noticed that the figure was that of a young man picking up starfish one by one and tossing each one gently back into the water. He came closer still and called out, "Good morning, may I ask what it is that you are doing?" The young man paused, looked up, and replied, "Throwing starfish into the ocean." The old man replied and smiled and said, "I must ask then, why are you throwing starfish into the ocean?" To this, the young man replied, "The sun is up and the tide is going out. If I don't throw them in, they'll die." Upon hearing this, the elderly observer commented, "But young man, do you not realize that there are miles and miles of beach, and there are starfish all along every mile, you cannot possibly make a difference. The young man listened politely, then he bent down, picked up another starfish, threw it into the back, into the ocean pass, breaking the waves, and said, "That starfish, it made a difference for that one." This is the challenge for us in the workplace. Maybe we will not be able to bring salvation to everybody in the workplace, but to everyone where our presence has been felt favorably, it will make a difference in their lives. Thank you.